गुड मॉर्निंग स्टूडेंट्स, टू कंटिन्यू विद द हेल्थ असेसमेंट टुडे वी विल स्टार्ट विद द एग्जामिनेशन ऑफ द चेस्ट. इट इंक्लूड थ्री एग्जामिनेशन. फर्स्ट इज एग्जामिनेशन ऑफ द थोरैक्स एंड लंग. सेकेंड इज एग्जामिनेशन ऑफ द हार्ट. एंड थर्ड इज एग्जामिनेशन ऑफ ब्रेस्ट फॉर फीमेल क्लाइंट्स. So first I will tell about the examination of the lung. Actually the lungs are located inside the thoracic cage or cavity. The thoracic cage cavity is a bony conical shaped cavity. Borders at the top are narrow, then the base, middle part is called as the sternum. The sternum is divided into three parts. One is manubrium, second body, third xiphoid process. Ribs are of 12 pairs. 11 and 12 pairs are floating ribs. There are 12 thoracic vertebra. And diaphragm is the floor of the thoracic cage or cavity. It separates the thoracic cavity from the abdomen. So this is the general anatomy of the thoracic cage or cavity. The middle of a thoracic cavity, that middle area is called as mediastinum. Mediastinum contains heart, then esophagus, then trachea and the great vessels like abdominal aorta. The pleural cavities on either side of the mediastinum contain the lungs. Now the pleura, it is actually a two-layered membrane. It is forming an envelope around the lung. The parietal pleura lines inside of the chest wall and the diaphragm, and the visceral pleura is lining outside the lung. Between the two layers is a small cavity containing small amount of fluid which is needed for expansion of the lung. Then trachea and bronchus. The trachea is anterior to the esophagus. The length of trachea 10 to 11 centimeter long. And it divides into right and left bronchus. The bronchus is further divided into bronchi and acinus or alveoli. Function of bronchus to secrete mucus and capture foreign particles so that to prevent respiratory infections. And bronchi has also ciliary function which moves the trapped particles up to be expelled or swallowed. Then next is acinus. It is the functional respiratory unit. It consists of bronchiole, alveolar duct, alveolar sacs and alveoli, and gaseous exchange occur in the alveoli. So the major functions can be summarized as giving oxygen, removing carbon dioxide, maintaining acid-base balance and heat exchange. Heat is also lost during expiration. Now coming to the assessment regarding the lung. I have said that first we will do the examination of the lung. So the related questions or history for lung assessment will be, you have to ask about history of smoking, passive, active, then any cough, productive, non-productive, any history of allergy which is causing wheezing or breathlessness, chest pain, orthopnea, poor activity tolerance is there or not. There is a recurrent attack of pneumonia, bronchitis, history of tuberculosis, whether a person is working in an environment containing air pollutants. So these are related questions for lung assessment or history regarding lung assessment. second is objective data, that means we are doing the examination, measurements, diagnostic tests. So these are the objective data. In that only we will do the physical examination. So the physical examination related to the lung is same inspection, palpation, percussion, auscultation. Although percussion and auscultation is much more important because the lungs are filled with air and we are trying to hear the sounds which are from the lungs due to presence of air. When the lungs are not filled with air and any tumors, masses are there or fluid is filled inside or excessive air is accumulated in the lungs, that abnormality has to be noted, which is done with percussion and auscultation specially. So to start with the examination, we will divide the chest into three parts. First is posterior chest, then lateral, and then anterior chest. So posteriorly, what all things we will do first in case of while we are doing inspection. Inspection means through the eyes we will see. We will see the symmetry of the posterior chest, any spinal deformity like lordosis, kyphosis, scoliosis. Then we have to note the position of the person to breathe, whether he is having orthopnea, that is he can breathe only in upright position, not able to breathe in supine position. Then skin color condition, nail color, clubbing can also be seen simultaneously. Pedal edema can be examined simultaneously. The normal configuration or shape of the chest is shown in the diagram. When the lungs are hyperinflated in case of obstructive pulmonary disease, this lung is always filled with air, that is barrel chest, it looks like barrel, that means antero-posterior diameter is increased, comparatively it is increased, so it looks like a barrel. Then this one is the anatomical deformity called as pigeon chest. Pigeon chest is the lower sternum is projected out, so the person's chest is looks like a pigeon. Next anatomical deformity can be funnel chest, pectus excavatum, in which the sternum is depressed. Now coming to the examination again, the posterior chest, I have said about inspection of the posterior chest, then the chest the configuration or not, the shape of the thoracic cavity, and then the posterior chest is palpated. The diagram shows how you will do the palpation. Before palpation, the hands should be warmed up. After palpation, important way to do examination is percussion. So the percussion means tapping. In percussion also we will try to hear sounds from the body. So it starts from the apex of the lung, apices of the lung, across the shoulders, and then interspaces side to side. Avoid scapula and ribs, because scapula over the scapula and over the ribs you will not hear any type of sound, because these are all bony organ, bony parts. Scapula is a bone, ribs are also bony. Now the percussion notes which are heard over the lung are called as resonance. Resonance means the lungs are filled with air. Hyper resonance means there is too much air, which is also a disease condition of the lung, especially in chronic obstructive pulmonary diseases. Dull sounds are quite abnormal. Dull sounds means whether person has that lungs are having some masses or there is excess amount of fluid or water collection in the
pleural cavity. Then the diagram shows the area of resonance, dullness and flat sound while you are doing percussion. The next step will be auscultation. Auscultation, the diagram is showing how we will do the auscultation of the posterior chest. We will proceed again same, proceed from the apex and then towards the end, towards the base. So on auscultation, the sounds will be on, I have said that on percussion the sounds are resonance, hyper resonance and flat, dull. So in auscultation the sounds are called as bronchial, which is heard over the anterior chest only. Posteriorly you will not be able to hear. It is heard over trachea and larynx. The characteristics of the sound is given in the slide. Second sound on doing auscultation will be bronchovesicular. It is heard over the anterior chest as well as posterior chest, heard over major bronchi between the scapula, anterior upper sternum, first and second intercostal space. ICS is intercostal space. And the third important sound, normal sounds on auscultation, is vesicular. It is heard anterior, posterior as well as on lateral side. That means the predominantly over the lung fields vesicular sounds. On percussion the sounds were called as resonant. On auscultation the sounds are called as vesicular, bronchial, bronchovesicular. So on auscultation, if you see the diagram, the area in the posterior chest, you will be able to find out where the bronchovesicular sounds are heard and where the vesicular sounds are heard. Now on auscultation, if these three sounds are not present or any extra abnormal sounds are present, that is called as adventitious sounds. Adventitious means abnormal sounds. Normally they should not be present. One abnormal sound is crackles, which is the showing the presence of fluid. And second is pleural friction rub, that occurs due to the inflammation of pleura. Then wheezing sound, when there is narrowing of the trachea and bronchi, especially it is seen in asthma. Stridor, it is a high pitched inspiratory sound. So these are all abnormal sound and it occurs due to the obstruction in the upper airway, in the larynx or in the trachea. Posteriorly, the areas of sounds which are heard on auscultation, I had already said. Now laterally, when you are doing lateral chest, when it is examined, the percussion notes which you will find are resonant, and the breath sounds which are found on examination of the lateral chest are vesicular. Now let us see the examination of the anterior chest. Again same pattern will be followed. We have to inspect shape and configuration, level of consciousness, expression, skin color, condition, quality of the respiration, no retraction, use of accessory muscles which are not used normally on respiration. That means patient is feeling difficulty to breathe. Then next sequence will be doing a palpation.
In that, we have to find out that whether the expansion of the chest is symmetrical or not. And on palpation, we can also find out whether some area is tender. Tender means painful or not. The diagram shows use of accessory muscle while breathing. This is seen in patients who are experiencing difficulty to breathe. The anterior chest is palpated like this for symmetric expansion. Then the anterior chest, how we will do percussion? Same technique, start from apex towards and then proceed towards the base. So the different sounds which are heard on percussion are resonance, flat sound, dull sound. So flat sound is heard over the bony area, dull sound over the solid organ liver, tympanic sound again near the stomach, and predominantly resonant sounds are present while you are percussing the anterior chest. On auscultation of anterior chest, what all sounds can be heard? Bronchial, as I had said that it is heard over the tracheal area, bronchovesicular sounds, then vesicular sounds are heard. The diagram you can see the areas where the three different sounds can be heard. So after doing the examination, what all things we will write in the examination of the lung? We have to write the respiratory rate, depth, type of respiration, then symmetry of respiration, use of accessory muscles, orthopnea is present, dyspnea is present or not, we have to write this one. And then we have to mention the breath sounds. Then coming to the next examination will be the examination of the heart, that is cardiovascular system. So examining the heart consists of asking questions or taking history. The related history are like we have to ask about dietary pattern, smoking, alcohol, intake of fat, intake of sodium. Then the questions related to the cardiovascular problem like chest pain, palpitations, excessive fatigue, dyspnea, edema of feet, fainting episodes, orthopnea, etc. Then we have to ask also whether the client has diabetes along with the symptoms of cardiovascular disease. Then intake of coffee, tea, caffeine, soft drinks, amount of stress. These are all some questions which are related to the when you are doing the examination of the heart. So the assessment will start anteriorly only. It is done through anterior thorax. Now the one term is called as precordium. Precordium is the region of the anterior surface of the body covering the heart and lower thorax. It is in the center of the chest behind and left to the sternum with a small section of the right atrium extending to the sternum's right. The base of the heart is the upper portion and the apex is at the bottom tip. The surface of the right ventricle composes most of the heart's anterior surface, and section of the left ventricle shapes the left anterior side of the apex. So the anterior surface means the right ventricle and a portion of the left ventricle. The apex of the heart touches the anterior chest wall at 4th to 5th intercostal space. That you should try to remember while you are auscultating the heart sound, because at that point when you are putting a stethoscope, if the physician puts a stethoscope at the 4th or 5th intercostal space, maximum the audibility will be heard, and that is called as point of maximum impulse, PMI. Precordium basically is the area where the heart is located. So precordial area it is also called. So the landmarks, it is in the diagram. The clavicle is divided, the middle clavicular line, then anterior axillary line. So the lines are showing for doing a precordial examination, that means examination of the heart. Continuing with the examination of the heart, while you are doing precordial inspection, a precordial examination, in the inspection part, chest is exposed and look for scar, visible pulsation, pacemaker, abnormal chest shape. Then on auscultation, this is a main portion of examination of the heart. Percussion is not normally done, only auscultation is done. So auscultation, in auscultation there are two heart sounds, one is S1, another is S2, which is called as lub and dub sound. So when the ventricles are filled, pressure rises in the left ventricle and mitral valve closes to prevent regurgitation of the blood, which is causing first heart sound S1, which is called as lub. And when ventricles contract and cause the blood to be pushed towards the aorta, the aortic valve closes. The closure of aortic valve produces second heart sound called as S2 or dub. So lub and dub sounds. Then there are certain abnormal heart sounds called as murmurs. Murmurs is due to turbulent blood flow, that means unidirectional flow of blood. When it is disrupted, then murmurs can be heard. When the valve is not closing properly, or when the blood is flowing through a narrow or stiff valve, then murmurs can be heard. So this is examination of heart. The third part is the examination of the breast. So examination of the breast is done for female patients, and only if the client says that she has any disorder of that breast, then breast examination is performed. So just to review the anatomy of the breast. Breast is composed of muscles, ligament, glandular tissue, fatty tissue and lymphatic tissue. These are examined for enlarged lymph node, because the breasts are a common site for malignancy or cancer. So these related questions can be asked, or we can say that breast examination is specially done for these particular clients, the age over 40 years, female who are having early menarche before 13 years, late menopause after 50 years, first child after 30 years, or the woman who has no children, then the woman who are using regularly oral contraceptives, on diuretics, or they are on steroids, or there is any family history of breast cancer. So for that, detailed breast examination is required. So you have to ask whether the patient has pain, any type of lump which she feels, thickening or tenderness in the breast, or any discharges from the nipple which is not normal. And then the breasts are examined through two techniques. One is inspection, another is palpation. On inspection, inspect both the breast for size, symmetry, retraction of the skin, which is seen in cancer, color of the skin, axilla and the supraclavicular area has also to be examined through inspection, and examination of the nipples through inspection, whether they are symmetrical, flat, inverted, any discharge present, bleeding of the nipples is there, any ulcerations are there. Next important technique to do examination of the breast is the palpation. So palpate all the area of the breast along with the axillary area. So this is the area of breast examination, and even the diagram is showing the percentage of the cancer of breast found in each according the percentage is also there related to the cancer. So this the diagram is showing the breast is also divided into quadrant, four quadrant along with the axillary tail. After breast palpation, examination of the nipple is done. So this was all about examination of the chest, which had three parts. Now I will tell about the abdominal examination. So the subjective data or the history related to the abdominal assessment are, we have to ask about pain, low back pain. We have to observe the patient's movement and position when he is lying still and knees drawn up or moving restlessly because of pain. Then ask the patient for bowel habits. Has constipation or diarrhea, character of the stool, any bleeding or not. Then ask patient about any abdominal surgery which has been done on the patient, any diagnostic procedures which has been performed before, then any intolerance to any type of food, allergy to any type of food, recent weight changes, whether the weight has been increased or decreased very much. This is also related to some cancers. Then and intolerance to certain diet, which can cause change in the weight or reduction in the weight. Then we have to ask difficulty in swallowing. If the patient has dysphagia, difficulty in swallowing, then also there is problem related to the esophagus. Then patient has excessive flatus or flatulence, belching or regurgitation or bloody emesis, that means vomiting which is which has blood, then black or tarry stool, that means melena, heartburn, diarrhea, constipation. So these are very important questions while you are doing abdominal assessment. And ask the patient to locate for any tender area. Tender means area which is very painful. And alcohol also, because it will affect the liver and pancreas. So these questions has to be asked. So in abdominal examination, the general inspection, when you are doing inspection, see for nutritional state, the wasting is there, weight loss is there, pallor, jaundice, pigmentation, and mental state. Mental state, jaundice, these are related to the disease of liver. Now the abdomen, when is examined, the patient should be in supine position, and the abdomen is conveniently divided into four quadrants. Otherwise the anatomical region of abdomen is 9, which is shown in the next diagram.
try to remember the areas of abdomen so that you can write where the stomach is located, where the patient is complaining. Accordingly you have to write the area. Like the liver is located in the hypochondrium region. The intestines are on the lumbar region. Before doing examination of the abdomen, ask the patients to void. Otherwise, it is very uncomfortable for the patient. Patient needs to relax. Appropriate draping should be there. Privacy should be provided. Then expose the abdomen just above the xiphoid process down to the symphysis pubis. We have to warm the hands and stethoscope. Assess the tender areas, which are painful areas. It has to be examined at the last. And you should have a tape measure while you are doing the examination to measure the abdominal circumference or abdominal girth. So the things which has to be recorded while you are doing inspection: skin condition, scars, stria, bruises, pigmentation, shiny abdominal skin, prominent veins are present over the abdomen. Then shape of the abdomen is round, concave, protuberant, distension. Don't confuse distension with obesity. Then any type of enlarged organs are there or not on inspection. Pulsations are, any visible pulsations are present or not. So the abdomen on supine position, the different shapes are flat, scaphoid, rounded and distended or protuberant abdomen. Then inspection of the umbilicus: normal, flat or concave. Color should be same as that of surrounding skin. If umbilicus is everted, the distension, upward protrusion of the umbilicus is present, then it can be a sign of herniation. Or any discharge is present, then it is abnormal. Now this diagram shows visible prominent veins over the abdomen, which is seen in certain disease. These veins are called as caput medullae. These can also be inspected. Then ascites, distended, the skin is shiny. It is because of excessive fluid accumulation. Then come to auscultation. Auscultation, by this we will be able to hear the sounds from the bowel, from the intestine. So air and fluid movements causes soft and gurgling sound, which occurs irregularly at 5 to 35 times per minute. Sounds usually last for half to several seconds. To confirm that the bowel sounds are absent, it takes 5 minutes of continuous listening. After that only you can confirm that the bowel sounds are absent. And auscultate in all the four quadrants. Best time for auscultation is in between meals. Just after the meals, it is not recommended. And use the diaphragm of the stethoscope while you are doing auscultation of the intestine or the bowel. When the bowel sounds are absent, after any type of general surgery, paralytic ileus, infection of the peritoneum, peritonitis, bowel obstruction, etc., which is a very dangerous condition. And growling sound or loud sounds, these are seen in diarrhea, bleeding, inflammation of the bowel, excessive use of laxatives. Next is percussion.
on percussion also we will be able to hear the different sounds. Sounds are heard. Excessive flutters or gas, if it is present, it can cause tympanic sound. And generalized tympani is normally present, predominant over the abdomen because of air in the stomach and intestine. And dull sound is heard over the liver and spleen. Excessive tympanic sound or hyperresonant sound is heard over a gaseous distended abdomen. Then the last, actually palpation should be performed at last, and it should be done by an expert. Palpation can cause discomfort to the patient. Normally when you are doing palpation, you have to compress to a depth of around 1 cm in a dipping motion. Then gently lift the fingers and move to the next area. So it is done with the help of an expert. Survey each quadrant systematically and note for muscular resistance, distension, tenderness. Normally on palpation, the abdomen is smooth, consistent, soft and non-tender. That means it is not painful. If a patient is refusing for palpation, that is called as involuntary reflex guarding, that the abdomen is, it becomes rigid while you are doing the palpation, and this shows the sign of peritoneal irritation or peritonitis. So severe tenderness or pain is related to peritonitis, infection, tumor or enlarged or distended organs. This is the technique of doing palpation, always done by an expert. Now if a person has ascites, tympanic sound and the dull sound, the diagram is showing where you will hear the tympanic sound and where the dull sounds are present. Dull sounds will be heard where there is fluid collection. When the patient is lying supine and at side lying position. Rebound tenderness, this is a diagram which is showing, that means patient will feel pain. After doing the palpation, abdominal girth is measured, abdominal circumference is measured at the level of umbilicus, and it is done specially for a patient where the fluid is accumulated, like ascites, patient who has ascites. So this was all about the examination of the chest and examination of the abdomen. I will continue the topic in the next class. Thank you, students.